This PS3 is dead, let's do some organ harvesting. Great, the warranty sticker is gone, and the hard disk is missing. At least, we have an L model with a 65nm RSX. What's that sound? This PS3 is crumbling. What is that? Oh, a piece of broken plastic. Are the organs even healthy enough for harvesting? Let's find out by doing an autopsy. There are tons of screws to remove. Perfect for people who want to buff up their fingers. Yikes! That's disgusting! What even is that? Remember to wear protection when dealing with unknown biological hazards. Finally, it's clean enough for me to touch. Unscrew and unplug the power supply. Remove the Blu-ray drive. Unplug the wireless antenna. Eliminate the heatsink clamps and the hard disk holder. Finally, remove even more screws and take out the EMI shield. Let's read the syscon error log of this PS3, which is basically the medical history of the console. We want to make sure it has a healthy GPU. Attach the TX and RX to this device, and don't forget about the ground.
Do you connect ground wire as last? You are a total moron without brain, thank you.
Oh, he found out my dark secret. But as long as this console has a healthy brain, it's all fine. Hey PS3, how are you?
I am YLOD, thank you.
Let's see what kind of YLOD are you. I can see 1002 and 2124. I know 1002 has nothing to do with the RSX, but what is 2124? It seems it's related to the HDMI encoder. Then I guess the GPU is still healthy. That means organ harvesting time. First, we need to remove the cables and the motherboard. Ah, it's so dirty. Remember to remove the battery so that it won't blow up my house. Next, we need to install this PCB holder so that the motherboard won't become a lasagna after baking. As an amateur, I'm going to use the cheapest preheater I can find on the internet. Because I'm broke, I couldn't afford professional equipment like console king. Time to put the motherboard on top and turn on the preheater. I'm going to set the temperature to 125 degrees Celsius so that it is hot enough to boil away the water molecules trapped inside the board. Baking in progress. Tasty lasagna tonight as dinner. Meanwhile, it's time for me to go back to the slave camp so that I can earn enough money to pay my electricity bill. I finally made it back. Did you guys even try to rescue me? Never mind, let's work on this overcooked PCB. I want to remove the IHS, because I don't want the 4V RAMs to be destroyed by the heat. We need to apply flux to the RSX. Let's try this cheap Japanese flux, because I'm too poor to buy the legendary MTech flux for BJ rework. Make sure the flux also goes underneath the RSX. Alright, everything is ready, time to start. First, we need to cut open the hole where the RSX is located at. Then, tape down the four sides so that we won't mess up the SMD components nearby. Apply even more flux because it's never enough. Let's have a look at my setup. I have a thermocouple here to measure the temperature, and I have a hot air station nearby. And of course, they are all cheap and made in China. Okay, let's cover up this gigantic hole. It's important because the temperature near the RSX drops a lot without it. When I open it, the temperature crashes. When I close it, it goes to the moon. Enough BS, let's start. Stage 1, target temperature 140, then 160 and 180. As you can see, the board is still well below 180. So we need to increase the preheating temperature even more. Our goal is to make the board temperature 180. Okay, target temperature arrived. Apply even more flux and blow some hot air. We want to heat up the RSX to 250. Nudge it from time to time to see if it moves. It moves, time to extract it. Extraction successful. Let's have a closer look to see if the chip survives the extraction. Oh no, I knock off two tiny caps. I should have grabbed this side with no SMD components. Let's evaluate the situation to see how bad it is. I want to double check if the two caps are exactly the same before soldering them back. They are so small that it's difficult to measure them. It seems they are the same because they have the same capacitance. Okay, let's solder them back. First, apply brand new solder to the pads to make soldering easier. It's my first time soldering such a small cap, my hand is shaking like crazy. Use hot air to solder the caps back. I use the weakest airflow I can set on my hot air station, otherwise the cap will just fly away. Let's align it a little bit more. Perfect, let's move on to the next one. Wait, where's the other cap? It was right there, but it's now gone. Luckily, I have the recording of me soldering, let's rewatch it. Great, the two caps were still there. and suddenly one of them is gone. What happened? Oh no, alien abduction. Now, our first priority is to rescue our tiny cap. Where are you, my lovely little tiny cap? I go over every single soda ball I can find on the sponge to see if my cap is there. Maybe my cap is inside one of the soda balls. I need to melt it and rescue it. Are you inside? No? How about here? Also no? Oh no, it's nowhere to be found. Wait, what's that? Zoom in. Are you my tiny little cap? Yes, baby, let's go home. My tiny cap is back. Apply flux and blow hot air. Perfect. Let's check if my soldering is good. They are so small that I don't even know if I'm measuring what I want to measure. Let's have a physical inspection instead. Oh snap, what is this monstrosity? I can't believe my soldering skill is like this. I think I need to make sure they are not shorted together this time. I think they are fine. I will leave it as it is. Then it's time to clean the solder balls. I have this new toy, a gigantic soldering iron. Let's try it out. As usual, apply flux as much as you can. Wait, what? My iron temperature is at 390, but the solder balls are not melting at all. What is going on? Ah, I was holding the soldering iron upside down. Once I hold it correctly, everything works fine. Let's use the soldering wick to remove the solder balls faster. I hate it. It always gets stuck. Let's apply even more flux. I think I need to increase the temperature to unstuck it. Let's increase it to 430. I see a lot of smoke, but it just won't come off. Finally! I should apply even more flux to prevent it from getting stuck. Alright, so far so good. It won't get stuck now. It's my first time doing this. It's actually quite fun. I hope I didn't do anything wrong. I think I have removed all the old soda balls. Let's clean it with 99% IPA. From a yellow sticky RS6, it slowly becomes a clean shiny RS6. Now we have a freshly extracted RS6. Actually, I should have used this PCB holder instead of the reball station. Never mind. Let's measure if the RS6 is still alive after all those soldering shenanigans. I know there's a figure like this for the RS6 measurement, but since I'm
upgrade,
I have no idea what it means. Don't worry, let's watch Console King.
R6PLL, R6PDC, R6PDDR, RCPDIO, and finally, RCPDDA.
He did it so fast, but it looks easy. RS6VDDIO, RCVDDA, RCVDDIO, RS6VDDR, RS6VDDC. Where's the next one? Ah, here, PLLVDD. And finally, FBVDDQ. Here's the summary for my measurement, and these are the values I'm supposed to get. Most of them looks good, except these two. When in doubt, ask that one friend you can trust. I'm glad to have such a reliable friend. And here we go, we have a 65nm RS6. We just need to find our next test subject for the organ transplantation. Hey, you!
Resistance is futile.